everyone, and welcome to this year's birthday show and fundraiser for Black Trans Advocacy Coalition. This is the third annual one of these birthday shows that I have had the good fortune to be able to put on thanks to the help and talent of so many wondrous friends. So sit back, grab a drink of your choice, as I proudly present my virtual birthday show. Up first is me with the cover of a Will Wood song, Trigger Warning Death. Well, if winter comes and takes my life, will it be the death I had in mind? Or will I be captured in the ice to preserve the way I died? Well, at 27 will I see that I was born to be the man I'll be. And if I change myself, can I still stay me? Or did I just change my mind? Whoa, whoa, I am a point in time and space, and I am the truths that I create. And so where my matter takes that stand, no, it doesn't matter who I am. No, it doesn't matter who I am. And I'm gonna be.
I know, that song was so last year. As in, I am turning 28. But you see, here's the deal. This year I couldn't ask for my actual birthday off, and thus, I am not yet 28, and I am in fact a superstitious thing. And so due to my 27 club neuroses, I don't want to count my chickens before they hatch, and thus that last song. But this is my 28th birthday show, and if I said it once, I said it a billion times, if I live to be 28 years old, I will be immortal. And of course I don't fully truly believe that. I do actually adhere to facts and logic sometimes. But, as Joan Didion said, we tell ourselves stories in order to live. And that is what all this is about. My Kiki and Herb reference rhinestone teardrops, the milk, my promo, all that jazz. After all, I come from a long line of self-mythologizers. So I choose to believe in my own immortality, even though tentatively, since I've yet to cross my own self-imposed threshold. But nonetheless, tonight we go on singing. Speaking of singing, next up is a dear friend of mine, the wonderful Stevani Ross of Sunday Comes Afterwards, with a bunch of beautiful songs. Trigger Warning Gender Dysphoria.
They say you're supposed to love your body. They say you should know that it's good as is. You shouldn't deface it, but always embrace it. They say all this and they're probably cis. While hormones have made me more at home in the earthly frame I've been granted, I'm all too aware of my facial hair, which leaves me disenchanted. But I dream of having a Brinks truck of loot. I can drive to the Hair Removal Institute. Well, they'll slide a diabolical probe into each follicle and burn every beard here out by the root. I envy those envies who don't give a damn, who embrace what they've got and adore it. But I can't reconcile my 5 o'clock style. It only makes me dysphoric. The one silver lining of COVID is I keep my mask in place. If I don't say a word, then I never get stirred, 'cause no one can see my face. Still I dream of having a Brinks truck of loot I can give to a person at the institute, so they'll slide a diabolical probe into each follicle and burn every beard here out by the root. Healthcare is a human right. The U.S. system needs a full rewrite. My beard's a tiny issue, there's much more to surmount, but that doesn't mean that it doesn't count. And I dream of having a Brinks truck of loot I can give to a person at the institute, and they'll slide a diabolical probe into each follicle and burn every beard here out by the root. Yes, I dream of having a Brinks truck of loot I can give to a person at the institute, or they'll slide a diabolical probe into each follicle and burn every beard here out by the root. Yeah, I'm not editing that. It's good enough. Hi, everybody. My name is Stevani. My pronouns are they, them. And happy birthday, Catherine. I'm thrilled to be here for another year. And I hope we raise lots of money for a worthy cause. Okay, here's a song. Actually, this one, the idea for this one came from an acquaintance on Twitter who tweeted the first line, and I was like, I have to write the rest of this. So, well, it's a marvelous night for a doom scroll, with your battery charged all the way, and there's nobody else in the room, so my attention is on you to stay. It's a night when my rights are eroding, it's a plight that instills me with fear, and it feels like the height of foreboding, and I wish I could just disappear. You know the trolls come out, stir the pot, then their spleen. It's a parade of awful news and takes on your screen, but I can't stop this long doom scroll on you, my phone. The outrage and the dopamine from you, my phone. Well, the app doesn't stop recommending more new posts to delight and a cry. A beloved celebrity's trending, I'm afraid to go look and see why. There are fires consuming Australia, and the Russians are bombing Ukraine. And in Texas there's a bacchanalia of new laws all designed to cause pain. And every time I scroll up, I just tremble inside. And though I know that you'll hurt me, I keep on bleary-eyed, 'cause I can't stop this long doom scroll on you, my phone. The outrage and the dopamine from you, my phone. Well, it's a marvelous night for a doom scroll, with your battery charged all the way, and there's nobody else in the room, so my attention is on you to stay. I confess that the stress is quite awful, it's depressing and surely a crime. Well, I guess that it's technically lawful, but it sure isn't quality time. I wish that I could quit you and be done just like that, and yet I know I'll miss you and the memes with the cat. So I can't stop this long doom scroll on you, my phone. The outrage and the dopamine from you, my phone. So, yeah. Okay, this next one is a cover of a song by cover of a song by Tom Smith and Rob Boulder with some changes in the wording. Anyway, here it goes. It's called Rich Fantasy Lives. Whoa, hang on. Yeah, okay. It's not the ukulele, it's me. So long to see you and left you to stand in the doorway with his stringy red hair and his thousand yard stare. In his mind, he's the princess of Norway. As he takes down your order, she's crossing the fjord. Her white stallion spits foam as it races. Many Vikings have died trying to take her as bride, but a villain gets all her embraces. Rich fantasy lives, somehow he survives in a world he contrives. Inhibited trans folks and frustrated buys lead rich fantasy lives. From IT resurrects your PC with a boredom she barely suppresses. Though she rarely converses, she has more universes in her head than you've got addresses. She war games through weekends, leads armies and legions. She doesn't care how well you putted. She's browsing reality's infinite palette. She's seen yours and yours doesn't cut it. Rich fantasy lives. She quietly thrives in a world she contrives. Technodrone insects and cubicle hives lead rich fantasy lives. We're piling up fears, but we're out of frontiers. Some need to escape, but there's nowhere. Can't go to the moon, at least anytime soon. But an interspace trip costs you no fear. So don't be unkind to a wandering mind. Just say it again if we've missed it. Some whispering poem was calling us home to a place we know never existed. Rich fantasy lives, our peace bonded knives and our hyperspace drives. Until that old wardrobe or TARDIS arrives, we'll be rich fantasy lives. Rich fantasy lives, our comic shop dives and our Babylon fives. Till something better than this world arrives, we'll be rich fantasy lives. Rich fantasy lives. Okay, so this next one's a cover of a song by Bob Dylan. I again change a few words, but in this one I think it's like 9 words total and they're mostly pronouns. Not much. Anyway. Come gather around, people, wherever you roam, and admit that the waters around you have grown, and accept it that soon you'll be drenched to the bone. If your time to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone, for the times, they are a-changin'. Come writers and critics who prophesied with your pen, and keep your eyes wide, the chance won't come again. And don't speak too soon, for the wheel's still in spin, and there's no telling who that it's naming. For the loser now will be later to win, for the times, they are a-changin'. Come senators, Congress folks, please heed the call. Don't stand in the doorway, don't block up the hole. For they who get hurt will be they who have stalled. There's a battle outside and it's raging. It'll soon shake your windows and rattle your walls, for the times, they are a-changing. Come parents and leaders throughout the land, and don't criticize what you can't understand. Your kids of all genders are beyond your command. Your old road is rapidly aging. Please get out of the new one if you can't lend a hand. For the times, they are a-changing. The line is drawn, the curse it is cast. The slow one now will later be last. As a present now will later be past. The order is rapidly fading. And the first one now will later be last. For the times, they are a-changing. Ah, the sounds of Jersey City. Okay, I got one last one. Before I go, thanks again for having me. If you want to hear more of my music, I'm on YouTube and also on Spotify and Bandcamp and Apple Music and iTunes and all the other places except for Amazon because fuck Jeff Bezos. But anyway, under the name of Sunday Comes Afterwards, I have an album for that matter, and, okay, here goes my last one. I used to have a wardrobe full of jeans and cords for boys, and each one boasts a storage space the size of Illinois. There was room to hold my wallet and some tissues and a pen, and I never really knew just how good I had it then. But try shopping on the women's side, it's so absurdly hard to find a pair of pants with room to fit one credit card. So while boy clothes aren't generally a cause for reminiscing, I can't stand the lack of pockets, and I know what I am missing. Makers of fake pockets, oh how I so despise them. I don't think it is possible to over-criticize them. They say it's to preserve the line of sleeker silhouette, but that's garbage and they know it and it makes me so upset. I like wearing pretty dresses, skirts that swirl around the knees. They're comfy and they're pleasant in a gentle summer breeze. I'm also fond of leggings, they're like t-shirts just downstairs. And because I'm in New York, almost no one really cares. But the copier at work requires swiping my ID. To get into the house, I should also have my keys. They need to hold my phone, it is not just incidental. And when dresses come with pockets, half the time they're ornamental. Makers of fake pockets, they are utterly perverse. They take payola from Chanel to make you have to buy a purse. Now my handbags are delightful, they hold lots of stuff, and yet if I'm being forced to carry one, it makes me so upset. Someday there will be a change of weather. Someday we will stand up for what's right. Someday the oppressed will band together. Someday we will have an epic fight. Someday we will cleanse the land in fire. Someday tyrants everywhere will fall. All our foes will finally expire. And who will be the first against the wall? Makers of fake pockets, they're the worst to ever live. It's the one thing in the world that there are no grounds to forgive. Oh, the Nazis will be second, and the fascists may be third. Predatory payday lenders, they will also be interred. And you may think it's draconian, but ask me if I care. Cause we're gonna get the tailors when the revolution's here. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much, Stevani. That was truly magnificent. You can hear more music from Sunday Comes Afterwards during their monthly Sunday live streams. And listen to and buy their marvelous album, I Want a Refund. And their awesome seasonal holiday EPs on Bandcamp. Links to those as well as their website and Twitter are in the description.
In lieu of tipping, please consider donating to Black Trans Advocacy Coalition. Thank you so much once again, Stevani. That was terrific. So, I figured I'd address the elephant in the room, which is that, unlike years prior, I am sitting as opposed to standing for my MC bits. The truth of the matter is that I'm doing this for C-Punk harm reduction self-care reasons. But a more interesting answer would be to quote the brilliant Mix Justin Vivian Bond and say, "Why stand when you can sit, and why sit when you can lay down?" But I ain't laying down anytime soon. I am far too excited for our next brilliant performer. Next up is my marvelous friend Marie with a visualized poem about virtual reality.
This is Demon Girl 2-118.blend. At the top, there's a diagram. It's a rectangle, and it's divided into sections. It'll kind of explain it in the poem. I'm building a low-poly mesh to start my avatar. The low-poly mesh lets me catch any mistakes and glitches by using as few lines as possible to form the topology. Cube into sphere into nose and chin and lips. A topology is made up of a series of four-sided polygons, so the quads flow in strips around the figure. Five sides can glitch the texture in the final stage, can mess up the UV map. The XYZ of the 3D figure, and then the UV coordinates that write my 2D skin to flowing grids. I keep this diagram above at hand. The description of it is a rectangle of black line of medium weight. The rectangle is divided by the same weighted lines, first vertically into three sections and horizontally into two. Then from each top corner, a diagonal that reaches to form the corner of an inset rectangle that crosses the first dividing lines. In this way, the top edge of the rectangle goes from three divisions to, on the bottom edge, five divisions. This is how detail gets added, going from a flow of three quads to five. I use this where the wrist connects to the hand. The fingers need more detail and need more quads. How are many joined into one, adding without glitching? There are two bodies, one which I am with alone in my room. The other body that meets the world that flashes across eyes as avatar. She opens her legs and says, "Look, I made it myself."
Thank you so much, Marie. That was so cool. If you loved that as much as I did, you can check out Marie's zine, I Don't Want to Have a Body Anymore, with much more art similar to that which you just saw. And you can follow her online at hexe.exe.exeh on Insta. I apologize, I tried to do this part off book, but I'm so dyslexic. You can follow her online at hexe.exe.exeh on Insta, at www.twitch.tv/hexeexeexeh on Twitch, and at hexeexeexeh on Twitter, to see her work and her website. This one's easy. MarieHinson.com. Sorry, Marie. I wanted to get it right, and I don't want to mess it up anyways. Thank you so much, Marie. That was spectacular. Next is my awesome friend Ublek with a whimsical showcase of his artistic talent. Trigger warning, body horror, eye imagery, and immolation. And please note that this video contains flashing images that might be triggering to those with issues of photosensitivity.
as shown in their video, Ublek is currently taking commissions. You can message him on Instagram at wild_toothonions to commission him. Thank you so much, Ublek. That was astonishing. Next, we've got Refractory Period with a cavalcade of cool ukulele covers.
Hey y'all, we are Refractory Period.
Two girls, one...
Well, today we are a two girls, one uke sapphic sensation, I guess. So we normally do synth pop, but we got our start as a ukulele cover band. So we decided that we would kind of get back to our roots a little bit and do that for y'all tonight. So yeah, we got some stuff. Okay. Have a little bit more of a chill set today.
Yeah.
So hope you enjoy.
Yeah.
Okay. You got some Radiohead coming up.
Hell yeah.
Thank you. this man, he talks in fancy, buzzes like a fridge, he's like a radio. Come the police, arrest this girl, her Hitler hairdo is making me feel ill, and we have crashed a party. And then we are heading out for the night. So, happy birthday, Catherine.
Yes, happy birthday, Catherine.
And hope you all have enjoyed the set and enjoy our next song. Thank you.
loneliness like a heartbeat drives you mad. In the stillness of remembering what you had and what you lost and what you had. Oh, and what you lost.
Refractory period.
Two girls, one uke. Happy birthday, Catherine.
Yes.
And stick around. Enjoy the rest of the show.
Thank you so much, Refractory Period. Those were all such great songs, all sung and played gorgeously. And if y'all want to show appreciation for their music, as I encourage y'all to do, the band's virtual tip jars are all linked below in the description, as well as links to where you can listen to and buy more of their music, including the aforementioned synth-pop originals. Thank you so much, y'all. That was baller. Next, we've got my new pal Salem Quinn with some stunning visual art. They're also currently taking commissions, so if you happen to like what you see, please consider dropping them a line and commissioning a drawing. Trigger warning: blood, gore, violence, weapons, guns, and body horror.
We came to win the war. We won't
Fantastic. As aforementioned, they are currently taking commissions as well as selling buttons. But also, if you would like to tip them for the phenomenal art you just saw, their tipping info is $SalemTheSpirited on Cash App, $KMILLS231 on PayPal, and at KAIDEN-RYAN on Venmo. And their Instagram is SalemArtistry_. Thank you so much, Salem. Those drawings were fabulous. Next up is Jillian Rose with a beautiful autobiographical magical realism true story. Trigger warning: death, dying, hospice care, body horror, intrusive thoughts, and Alzheimer's.
The light. Mum was dying, her frail body languishing. The scars of her 86 years appeared as weathered hieroglyphs on ancient ruins, some of which I recognized, most I did not. I was afraid. The woman I adored and loved so much was disintegrating before me with every minute that passed. My mind kept flashing to actor Doug Jones, portraying a compilation of every grotesque character he'd mastered, with dehydrated lizard-like skin, limbs like autonomous snakes, and what I imagined, an odor of a cat hoarder's home. And I, her daughter, had committed my heart and soul that when the time came, I would take care of her so she could die at home. But this entity in the bed wasn't Mum, her physical being oozing the Alzheimer's that had invaded so many parts of her mind and memory, exposing someone I didn't know. Mum's ability to take care of her basic needs independently suddenly changed over the course of 12 short hours. I cried. I prayed. Mum needed help with almost every aspect of existence. She could blink, she could breathe, and occasionally spoke a few words, most of which were jumbled, but clearly, intermittently, and repetitively would strongly blurt out, "I'm fed up." She couldn't move her body below her waist. She had extreme difficulty with coordinating her upper body, arms, neck, and head. She didn't know the time of day, the month, or the year, and she certainly couldn't correctly identify the person standing next to her, me. I prepared to care for Mum. I had to formulate a plan of care, one that would meet Mum's needs, physical, mental, and spiritual, while maintaining her dignity and supporting her journey towards rebirth. I was guilt-ridden with a horrific sensory overload now invading my mind with thoughts of evil embodiment with a plan of its own. I was overwhelmed. My plan had to be clinical, developing the day's events in scrupulous details in my head, but at the same time, trying to detach myself from the reality of death looming in the room. What if death was coming for me? On many occasions throughout my life, I thought I would die before my mother. Was it going to be now? I argued with death in my head. No one can take care of Mum better than me. I wouldn't allow anyone else to take care of her and attend to her needs. Oh God, how freaking narcissistic, how pathetic, how selfish. Shamefully, I cried. I prayed. Back to my plan. I'd chosen clothes I would wear as my uniform, and because of the pandemic, I had stocked up on medical gloves, Clorox wipes, antibacterial and antiviral sprays. Supplies were not lacking. My brother rearranged the living room and set up a hospital bed. I'd scrubbed the bed frame and the plastic-covered mattress. I gave Mom a bed bath and washed her hair. I'd thoroughly cleaned the entire apartment, yet the rancid, penetrating smell contaminated each breath. It was late summer, so I could leave the windows open, which helped a bit. The scene was set, the players in their roles. Mum, the dying patient, me, her caregiver, and my brother, a companion who could comfort her, sit at her bedside, and be there for her. Each performance lasting 24 hours, without any understanding of when the final curtain would drop. I'd moved in. I learned early that first morning to leave the curtains closed all night and all day, which only added to the depressing room-turned-dungeon. It was so dreary. The area was thick and stale, and there in the bed, my mum, Mummy. As I looked at her, she appeared more and more like the mummies of old. I'm talking old and not well preserved. The long periods of apnea made me wonder if this was her last breath. But eventually, she'd take several shallow breaths before resuming a more regular rhythm. I stood there frozen for a few minutes before being completely startled. This mummy, this being, opened her eyes, now somewhat sunken, the piercing glare aimed at me. It fed my head games, overactive, dark thoughts of demons and monsters. My poor little mum. I cried. I prayed. I played a variety of Mum's favorite artists and tunes, as well as having quiet time, but that backfired with restless, awkward movements and forceful groans from the bed. I put on the TV for Mum's almost addiction to live tennis coverage. I know little about the sport. The constant echo of the ball bouncing and the metronome-like yells from the players hung in place, but settled the patient. Tennis it was. At times, I turn on my spiritual show, surprisingly without apparent objections. Jeopardy, Escape to the Country, or Shark Tank. Mum's shows also well received. She wasn't following any of them, but didn't squirm when they were on. Mum was sleeping about 20 hours a day. I donned my medical gloves and initiated the plan. Bed baths morning and evening, with repositioning, fluffing and buffing every 2 hours in between. Even through the non-latex medical gloves, I could feel every wrinkle exaggerated to craggy mountains and rocky valleys. I could feel every mole that had taken over her torso, arms, legs, and neck, like barnacles on a washed-up medieval shipwreck. I washed, I patted her dry, and carefully applied lotion everywhere, all the time praying, trying to channel healing thoughts through my touch. I cried, I prayed. During these frequent disruptions and interference to her seemingly comfortable naps, I would provide her with water, tea, clear juices or protein drinks using a dropper, literally one drop at a time. It would prove to be only about 50 to 60 milliliters a day, contributing to the depletion of fluids from her shriveling shell. She'd recently had trouble hearing, and in response hadn't been as talkative as she was known to be all her life, and hadn't been using the phone, which she had enjoyed immensely. But even so, after her evening bed bath and body rub, I would dial my child's number, hold up the phone for Catherine to talk to Tutu, grandparent in Hawaiian. Catherine would fill her in as to the crazy events of the day in the life of a performing artist in New York City. According to the expressions on her face, Mum seemed to listen, at times mumble something inaudible to me, and fall back to sleep. How many more times could Mum ask, "What's going on?" and "Who are you?" How many times can she say, "I'm fed up," or "call me lady?" Day one, day two, day three, four, five, six, seven, and eight. Each day seemed like a week or more. I cried, I prayed. My heart was heavy from wearing the lead shield that had allowed me to complete my tasks so far without melting into a gooey mess of emotion. I had to take it off, just for a few minutes. I stepped out of the room of death and doom onto the southwest facing third floor balcony and breathed. The air was sweet with the fragrance of early fall. In a good way, it took my breath away. The silhouetted pine, oak, and ash trees beneath the big starry sky whispered with a faintly familiar song. Time stood still for I'm not sure how long, until a corner of my mind, still in Mum's room, pulled me back to where I was and what I was doing. Was that reality, or is this? One more look at the heavens. At the exact moment, the longest, brightest shooting star arched towards the earth, a rainbow in the night sky. I hadn't seen a star that bright in the sky since Hale-Bopp in the 1990s, but that was a comet that hung in the northeast sky for months. This shooting star was huge, the best I'd ever witnessed, beautiful, and such a drastic contrast to the mummy's bedside where I had to go. I had to make a wish. I cried and I prayed. Please, God, help Mum. I stepped back in, forgetting to reapply my heart's armor, checked on Mum, and got ready to get a couple hours of uncomfortable rest on the love seat across from Mum's bed. A blink later, and the daylight was squeezing through a gap in the curtains. Obviously, I hadn't closed them the night before. I thought back to the brilliant shooting star I'd seen. I prepared for the morning routine, now almost robotic, but that is not how the day would go. For whatever reason, I grabbed a CD, seagulls and ocean waves, and put it on. No TV today. Growing up by the sea, I thought the soothing tides, interrupted by the calls of the gulls, was an easy path to Mum's carefree days gone by. I noticed on the wall above the head of the bed a spotlight like beam streaming through the gap in the curtains. I let it be. I glanced down at the being in the bed and did a double take. Was it the little bit of light coming in that made me see differently? I don't know what it was, but as I stared, trying to figure it out, she opened her eyes and questioned, "Oh, Jillian, am I still here?" I couldn't answer, trying to register the fact that she knew me. "I didn't think I'd still be here," she said with surprise. I was stunned. She knew me. I could see and hear my dear little old Mum. "Yes, Mum, you're still here. Me too. Where did you think you were?" The wrinkled old face smiled, wiggled her arm out from under the covers and pointed up towards the circle of light still in the same place on the wall above her head. Her eyes sparkled like diamonds, but she didn't say another word. She wasn't going to share. She was going to keep her secret. As I was used to doing, I started with a step-by-step explanation of what I was going to do, starting with her bed bath. It wasn't until I was applying the lotion did I realize I hadn't put on the protective medical gloves. I again was surprised. Her skin didn't feel like it did through the gloves. The deep scars and mountainous moles now resembled the Rosetta Stone. My massaging hands, powered with healing vibes, now able to decipher and understand the hieroglyphic patterns, reading them like Braille, her story. At once I could smell the flowers in the room, pulsating with the CD as if the scent were being carried by each wave, splashing over the sand and being absorbed before the next wave arrived. Mum, exhausted from her fluff and puff session, fell asleep. I cleaned up the bath time supplies, tidied the room, took out the garbage, watered the plants, and again checked on Mum. She looked comfortable, but there was still something different about her. I figured at some point the light on the wall above her head would shift and inevitably shine right in her face. Being the light was pretty much a circle, I thought it must be a reflection from one of the framed photos scattered on every surface. I moved one and then another, adjusting and checking the wall with each move. There must have been 100, plus the glass and ceramic knickknacks taking up whatever space was left on the shelves and tables. No go. I couldn't find the culprit. I didn't want to close the curtains. The daylight had contributed to this day being better than the last 8. The din of the tennis match replaced with sounds of the shore, the wretched odor replaced by a pleasing floral fragrance, and Mum seemed to be back, at least briefly. I went around the bed to close the curtain and did another double take. This time it was the ball of light on the wall. It should have disappeared when I walked in front of the gap in the curtains. It didn't. I tried to block the light by walking around the room. Nothing. Couldn't do it. I closed the curtains anyway, figuring my physics were off. The circular light dimmed but didn't vanish. Mum was sleeping soundly and deeply. I cried, this time because Mum had recognized me, called me by name, and because she isn't a monster, and because of the guilt I felt thinking that she was. I prayed, thanking God for the glimpse of my old Mum, for the grace given to me so I could continue to care for her, however long that was to be, and for lifting the dead weight off my heart that released the fear that had blown up and out of proportion over the last week. The CD had stopped. Silence hugged the room as I sat near the bed. Then, out of nowhere, a soft, flowing harmony of syllables touched my ear. Thank you, my child. I cried again, smiling. I sat quietly in awe and in prayer. I don't know when it happened, but the light on the wall was gone. The next turn and rub came quickly. I restarted the same CD, Mum awake, with a mischievous smile and seemingly knowing the answer, again asked, am I still here? As I washed and rubbed her back, Mum bragged about her family, a daughter, a nurse, a son, a cop, and a grandchild, an actor in New York City, one day to perform on Broadway, she proudly proclaimed. Ending her monologue of memories, she turned her head towards me, her face beaming, and said, I'm so lucky. I'm so very lucky. I cried. I prayed. I turned Mum on her side, facing away from the window, ready for her son's visit. I parted the curtains just a little bit. It was back. The light. It was back. It appeared in the same place on the wall. It was the same size, too. I thought I should be freaking out right about now, but wasn't. Why wasn't I freaking out? Why is this light exactly the same as it was 3 hours ago? The sun had moved. Was it a reflection off one of the photo frames? I juggled them all again without impacting the light. I still couldn't block it either, but figured I hadn't found the right spot. I left the curtains be, open just a bit. My brother showed up for his daily visit. He was pleased with the curtains being somewhat open, the fresh smell, the seaside sounds, and most of all, the peaceful expression on Mum's face. He sat holding her hand tenderly as she gently slept. I left for my break. Mum was in apartment 305. Mine was down the hall in number 309. 5 minutes later, I was in the shower. 20 minutes and I was in my bed. Steve would call me 15 minutes before he had to leave. I wouldn't know if you'd call in an hour or two, or maybe three. Last week, I couldn't get settled on my break. Now, I was asleep as soon as my head hit the pillow. I woke up to his call like I'd slept all night long. I headed back. As he quickly gathered himself to leave, he relayed their brief conversations, recalled their exchanges of love, and was brought to tears hearing Mum repeat, "I'm so lucky," many times during his 3-hour visit. He became verklempt and was out the door. Day 9 had gone really well. I cried, I prayed. Each subsequent day proved a little easier than the day before. The light would come and go, but remained in the same place on the wall and the same size when it did appear. The times Mum was awake were now longed for. I showed her the multitude of photos strewn around the room and spent time paging through her photo albums, not sure if she could even focus on the old mostly black and white photos. I recited to Mum as many of the stories I could remember she told to me over the years. I read out loud passages from the Bible, not done with Mum since I was about 7. And, believe it or not, we had a few giggles over silly things that had always colored our times together. Each conversation ending with the same thing from Mum, "I'm so lucky," as the light intermittently shone above her bed, sometimes reflecting stronger than others, but consistent in place, shape, and size. Mum continued to surprise me. One morning as I was doing the dishes, Mum started singing "Amazing Grace." I didn't know she knew the song, but here she was, belting it out as if in the cabin of St. Paul's Cathedral in London, needing to be filled. Her voice was strong and on key, and only toward the end of the second verse, as I made it back to the side of her bed, did it fade. Another occasion, during the quiet of the midnight hour, Mum was singing a vaguely recognizable tune, but I couldn't understand the words. "It's my favorite hymn," she said. I asked her to sing it again and again as I strained to understand the words. After the third time, I had to drill her. "What are you singing?" She didn't answer, but instead sang it again. I grabbed my notebook and started writing down what I heard phonetically. It wasn't English. She drifted off to sleep. I later found the match, all through the night, in Welsh. She had spent much of World War II in Wales, a long time ago. As time passed, the periods in between Mum's naps shortened. She was still interacting with me, with my brother, and a few others undetectable by those of us in this flesh and blood world. Each night, ending her day with a phone call to Catherine in New York. The light continued to shine on her wall unpredictably. I cried, I prayed. She hadn't eaten for over 6 weeks. The drops of liquids I could provide safely had decreased, measuring less than an ounce a day. She wasn't consuming enough fluids for a baby bird to survive, yet her skin appeared more hydrated. The wrinkles receded and were now limited to left lines at the corners of her eyes. The scars gone, the moles and bumps smoothed without evidence they were ever there. Her hair had more bounce and shine, and the sparkle remained in her eyes. Mum looked younger and more beautiful each day, just like her high school photo. How can this be? One thing that didn't change was her newly acquired mantra, "I'm so lucky." It had been 29 days since the light appeared and we still hadn't made sense of it. But whatever it was, it had completely eased my early fantastical imagery of Doug Jones's gruesome characters that first week. I wasn't afraid at all. That day, my brother's visit had been later and longer than usual, and the bond between mother and son visible in all its brilliance of genuine love and glory. One last, "I'm so lucky," from Mum sent him on his way. A couple hours later, I was holding up the phone for Mum. She was listening to Catherine. At the end of the call, her grandchild, as every night, said, "I love you, Tutu." Mum replied, "Ditto, darling, ditto," as she gently fell asleep. That was it. Those were her last words, her last conscious moment. She stopped responding verbally and wasn't waking up. Her breathing shallowed with longer periods of breathless silence. The now familiar and reassuring light remained above her bed. 2 days later, and adjusted to Mum's new state of being, I gingerly repositioned and massaged her body as I again cried and prayed. I settled down on the love seat for the night when I heard an unusual sound coming from Mum's bed. Over the last few weeks, her breathing that had become so labored with extended periods of apnea was normal. Suddenly, she was breathing really normally. Regular rhythms and strong, deep breaths. It was 11 o'clock at night. I got up and slowly walked over to check on her, the faded light on the wall enhancing my view of Mum in the bed. Mum was sleeping. She looked comfortable, as a child snuggled in on a cold winter night without a care in the world. I sat next to her bed. I stroked her hair, told her for the umpteenth time how much I loved her, and thanked her for being my mum and best friend. I told her again how much I was going to miss my buddy and the shared perspective no one else could or would ever understand. I cried. I prayed. It had been 40 days and 40 nights. She took another breath, her last. As the light on the wall gradually dimmed and vanished, I knew instantly with every fiber of my being, the protective light guarding my mom, guiding her home, was the love of her life, her husband of almost 30 years, her soulmate Barry. Mom peacefully slipped into her forever after. I cried, I prayed.
Thank you so much, Jillian. That was absolutely miraculous. In lieu of tips, please consider donating to Black Trans Advocacy Coalition. Thank you so much once again, Jillian Rose. That was truly divine. As aforementioned, while this is my birthday show, it's also a fundraiser for Black Trans Advocacy Coalition, a magnificent Black trans-run organization that focuses on the bettering of lives of Black trans people through health, housing, and employment. You can learn more about the vital work they do down in the link in the description. Thank you so very much to everybody who's already donated so generously thus far. And never you fear, there's still plenty of time if you want to join in and put the fun in fundraising.
So this is the part of the show where ordinarily we'd have the Mixed Money Bags halftime show, but this year I'm not so certain that I really have the spoons for that.
What are you talking about? You've got plenty of spoons.
Yeah.
Actually, those aren't the kind of spoons I meant. In this context, when I say spoons, I'm really referring to energy and ability and...
And forks and knives.
No, I mean...
And just look at all these straws! And maybe even a spork! Yeah, I want to find a spork!
Okay, well, while they're off trying to find a spork, I'm going to show y'all some of their TikToks since they fancy themselves influencers now. So that this still serves the purpose of being able to give y'all the opportunity to powder your nose or do whatever y'all need to do.
I always feel like somebody's watching me, and I love the rocks. Oh.
Hey, Mixed Money Bags, I heard that you were going to make a TikTok to a Bo Burnham song. Wow, I love how the world works.
No, not that one. I don't like that song. Why did you think I was gonna do that one?
Oh, no particular reason.
CEO, entrepreneur, born in 1964, Jeffrey Bezos. CEO, entrepreneur, born in 1964, Jeffrey Bezos.
into it, pave the way, put your back into it, tell us why, show us how, look at where you came from, look at you now. Zuckerberg and Gates and Buffett, amateurs can fucking suck it, fuck their wives, drink their blood, come on Jeff, get 'em!
Jiggle, jiggle, it folds, I like to see you wiggle, wiggle. For sure, it makes me want to dribble, dribble. You know, riding in my Fiat, really had to see it. 6 feet, 2 in a compact, no slack. But luckily the seats go back. I got a knack to relax in my mind, sipping some red, red wine. I said, jiggle, jiggle, it folds, I like to see you wiggle, wiggle. For sure, it makes me want to dribble, dribble. You know, riding in my Fiat, really had to see it. 6 feet, 2 in a compact, no slack. But luckily the seats go back. I got an act to relax in my mind, sipping some red, red wine.
Red, red wine, red, red wine.
Oh my goodness, we did it!
We found the spark.
Well, with that awesome discovery, we will now transition on to the next act, which, oh, it's me again! As I said, the next set is me again with a triptych of original songs. I hope you all enjoy. Trigger warnings, and there's a lot, so I don't usually do this, but I'm cheating because it's me and there's three. Trigger warning: mental illness, hallucinations, childhood trauma, child protective services, dead animals, involuntary institutionalization, blood, gore, body horror, mental illness stigma, and dying young. I see dragons on the ceiling, mummified mice on the floor, and the ghosts come with me always. Who could ask for anything more? All the toys a kid could need, and most aren't even mine. There's not much room to play inside. Still, this life suits me fine. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. It's not only child's imagination turning cracks to creatures, it's perpetual treasure hunts and fears of well-meaning teachers. But we're from the Midwest, of course. Private matters stay at home. But given that I am unable to lie, I know I need to roam. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. But you can't run from fate. I hate that I know this too well. I've said before, I'll say again, there are reasons I can knell. So for now, I'll keep that DSM book high upon the shelf. And since I've no time to get locked up, I'll keep my visions to myself. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. If I tell the truth to anyone real, they will just take me away. My own bed is like a half pipe now, or sinking ship Titanic. There are angels in my shower now, but maybe I'm just manic. I'm possessed often by demons and see them across the way. I don't know why I'm like this, 'cause I know I want to stay. And I would love it simple. And I would love it clean. And I would love up-tempo. And I would love serene. But that is not my language. And that is not my choice. I don't like how those words sound when they are in my voice. I sing with blood in my mouth, sparkling off teeth that gleam. Psyche that's fucked and fragile, pulled apart at the seams. I've come to terms with madness. I call myself insane. You know that sanity's a myth, right? Concocted to sell more brains. Ha! I don't know when I'm joking or when I am sincere, but what does it matter, really, so long as I persevere? I wish that I were something stable and good and pure, but then I'd lose my sparkle. What are coping mechanisms for? I think perhaps I'll get better and grow out of this phase, but then I am left to wonder just how will I spend my days. Maybe I'd get some hobbies, focus on my career, but then how would I manage when all that I know is here? I was raised up in chaos. A flower grew out of dirt. I'm doubled over with anti-pain the second that I don't hurt. So I say I'm a monster. It's far easier this way. The time will come to give it up, but that's for another day. And so I ask you, darling, if you're willing to stay, will you abide my antics? Can you take me this way? If you say no, I don't blame you. Ain't no skin off my nose. It's better for everyone anyway to be alone as I decompose. 'Cause perfect accepting people are martyrs in their own right. And I don't want those I love to feel like they have to fight. I can stay in my room. I can pretend I write songs safe inside of my tomb with no one to right all my wrongs. I think that I can take it. I'm selfish and stupid and strong. I may well be immortal, but life really ain't that long. I am childish and broken, feared 'cause I am afraid, fully fucking committed to die in this bed I made, complete with my fake incisors, fangs as sharp as my claws, ribs the crack cutely open, dislocating like my jaws. Every part of me is unhinged, but I still don't have a name to scream so that I am summoned to whisper so I am tame. So as is customary for the type of triptych that I'm doing, which I won't bore y'all with the minutiae, but I learned this type of technique from my teacher, Joey Clark, back at SPCPA, old days. Yeah, shout out to Joey if you're watching somehow, somewhere. I need to drink more water because, as my good friend Nathan Carrera says, the phlegm goddess hath blessed me today. I literally took a shot of Robitussin before we began this, but anyways, I'm getting off track. The track that I am supposed to be on is giving y'all a little insight about the technique, kind of riffing off last year. So that last song, it's called Demon Sona, and I always make this joke about it. It's all verse, just like me, but I'm very hilarious and charming. But my point is that I realize this next song is also has its own technique joke, like completely unintentionally, because it's kind of the opposite of Demon Sona in that way, and I'm fixing my star because it's stabbing me in the eye. It's kind of the opposite of Demon Sona in that way, insofar as, like, Demon Sona, it's all kind of the same thing. But this one has two disparate, different from one another parts to it, and it weaves in and out. And then I was thinking about that, and I'm like, that is so perfect! I'm accidentally brilliant sometimes, apparently, because the reason why that's fabulous is that it's a song about the beepadeeps, beepadeeps meaning borderline personality disorder, which is a phrase, the beepadeeps, that I stole from Sophie from Mars, who has a glorious video about the beepadeeps. But point being, This is a song about the Beepadeeps, and anyone who knows, I don't know why I was going to call it the lore of BPD, but anyone who knows the lore of BPD will understand that dialectics are important, and I do my best to do my dialectics, and I'm trying my best every day, and yeah, but this is a song about the Beepadeeps and being Beepadeep for Beepadeep, and yeah, anyway, gotta offset the phlegm goddess's blessings a little bit more here. See? I wasn't lying. I don't lie. Dislocating like my jaw. This is part of me. Anyway. Folks like us are a resilient bunch. We struggle and survive. Folks like us do whatever at all it takes to stay alive. I wanna take her in my arms and stroke her pretty hair. I messed it up already, but I'm able to start over because if my idols can, then so can I. Folks like us are a resilient bunch. We struggle and survive. Folks like us do whatever at all it takes to stay alive. I wanna take them in my arms and stroke their pretty hair. Say, baby, don't you listen to what they say out there. They tell us that we're toxic, but they don't understand the things that you and I have had to live through firsthand. But there will come a time and there will come a day, 'cause you and I both know somehow somebody's gotta stay. So please just keep on living, 'cause someone's gotta stay. And our love has never felt toxic. No, our love has never felt toxic. No, our love will never be toxic. Folks like us are good at words, at self-diagnosis and naming. Folks like us go, oh, it me, and are experts at reclaiming. I wanna take her in my arms and stroke her pretty hair. Say, baby, don't you listen to what they say out there. They tell us that we're toxic, but they don't understand the things that you and I have had to live through firsthand. But there will come a time and there will come a day, 'cause you and I both know somehow somebody's gotta stay. So please just keep on living, 'cause someone's gotta stay. And our love has never felt toxic. No, our love has never felt toxic. No, our love will never be toxic. Folks like us, we write our songs but don't know if we'll live to get old. Folks like us still find ourselves just grasping for a hand to hold. I wanna take him in my arms and stroke his pretty hair. Say, baby, don't you listen to what they say out there. They'll tell you that you're toxic, but they don't understand the things that you and I have had to live through firsthand. But there will come a time and there will come a day, 'cause you and I both know somehow somebody's gotta stay. So please just keep on living, 'cause someone's gotta stay. And our love has never felt toxic. No, our love has never felt toxic. No, our love will never be toxic. Folks like us write what we wanna hear in order to feel assured. Folks like us sing in our own voices just to hear these words. So hold me in your arms and stroke my pretty hair. Tell me not to listen to what they say out there. They tell us that we're toxic, but they don't understand the things that you and I have had to live through firsthand. But there will come a time and there will come a day, 'cause you and I both know somehow somebody's gotta stay. And I will keep on living, 'cause someone's gotta stay. That's all. Thank y'all. Thank you so much for listening. And if you liked those songs, or even if you didn't, please consider supporting Black Trans Advocacy Coalition. Last year we reached $1,000, and it would be such a dream if we reached that or even exceeded that, once again this year. But of course, every little bit helps, and even if all you can afford right now to give is your time and attention, that is more than enough, and I am extremely grateful for it. Next up is my pal Carlotta with a birthday message.
Catherine, happy birthday! I'm so happy that we met, even though it's all been virtual. I hope to one day meet in person, but I just wanted to send this video and wish you the best happy birthday, because you truly are such a shining light in the world, and I think you just give a lot of people a lot of hope and like freedom to be themselves, and you're beautiful and charming and talented, and I'm just so happy that we met. And I want to say happy birthday, and also, you know, it's just so great what you're doing for your birthday, putting on this show, which is so enjoyable to watch and also helps people, and it's just so you. So just congratulations and thank you for being you, and happy fucking birthday.
That was so sweet, Carly. Thank you so much. If you want to see Carlotta's work as a filmmaker, you can check out her website, www.carlottaplies-garzado.com. There's some really cool music videos there, as well as a whole bunch of other exceptional work. The link is in the description. Thank you so much, Carly. That was beautiful. Next up is my phenomenal pal, Germ, with a project that they are going to introduce themselves. Please note that their piece also includes flashing visuals, so possible epilepsy warning to whom it may concern.
Hi everybody, this is Germ Lynn, and I wanted to do a video greeting for Catherine on their birthday. Happy birthday, Catherine. Thank you for all you do to support artists and be in community with artists and friends and just being the person you are in this world and connecting with other people like you do. And thank you for doing the fundraiser for the Black Trans Advocacy Coalition. I hope everybody donates. Virtual tips can be sent to me at glin-19-89, and it says stay punk. And I'm just going to be doing a little video show for my musical act, which is Witch Wife. We're on Insta, spelled, you know, at Vivitch for Vife, Witch Wife with two V's. And it's just basically like a sonic quilt of covers and just sort of yarns and different musical threads all lifted up and put together with some visuals. So I hope you do enjoy. And a few promotional things for myself is that I now have a poetry chapbook out on called Pressured Speech, and it's out on Bottle Cap Press. So check out Bottle Cap Press or Google Germlin Pressured Speech. That's also a great way to support my work. And happy birthday, Catherine. I hope that you have a good one. Sky.
packs their stuff. The front yard slick with mud. The thunder claps, serrates the sky. I don't mean well, I don't know why I try. Gets me every time. Take a crooked halo. I got a new best friend. She's got eyes in the back of her head, so she can see you crawling back. And she'll whisper, keep on walking. You ain't no man's pillar of salt. She read the book of Revelations, said it was all your fault. Told me, baby, you'll need that soul. He took me to the darkest valley when he said that he would take me home. When I got down into the gully, I climbed into a car on the blocks. Didn't have no coat or blanket with me, just had to be there with my thoughts. That sit and rot. Can't say what happened to my heart when I got left there with my thoughts. So don't come looking for me, Johnny. I got a new best friend. She says forgiveness ain't what's gonna cure me, and I'll be all alone in the end. She says while she's prophesizing, you ain't no man's monument to justice. You have revenge and a gun, and it's all you have. When you are lost and you're broken, you've been hurt so bad. Don't come looking for me, Johnny. I got a new best friend.
Mm-hmm. keeps retreating. You can seem to get enough. With my love, open the door. With my love, open the door. With my love, open the door to your heart. Don't tear my heart, my achy, breaky heart. Just don't think you understand. And if you tear my heart, my achy, breaky heart, just might stop and kill this man. However far away, I will always love you. No matter how long I stay, I will always love you. Whatever words can't say, I will always love you. I will always love you. I will always love you. Gonna take a lot to take me away from you. There's nothing that 100 men or more could ever do. There's so many songs that I miss. What's on the other side? Needless my visions, nearly illusions. Nameless, have nothing to hide. I look at clouds from both sides now. I bless the rain. I look at clouds from both sides now. I bless the rain. I look at clouds from both sides now.
You can follow Witch Wife on Insta at Witch Wife with 2 V's to make the W's, just like the movie with Black Phillip. And if you would like to live deliciously, you can buy their chapbook, Pressured Speech, at the link below. And tip them at GLYNN-19-89 on Venmo. Thank you so much once again, Germ. That was truly incredible. Up next is the inimitable Tenacity Plies reading an excerpt from their brilliant, recently published novella, Family Curse, Field Notebooks, 1880 to 2020. Trigger warning: death, ableism, COVID, involuntary institutionalization, and threats of queer bashing.
Thanks so much to Catherine for letting me be here for the second year in a row. Happy birthday from a fellow Scorpio. I've got my book here to read, Family Curse, Field Notebooks, 1880 to 2020. It's out now. I've been promoting it for a while, and it's really nice to share it, you know, with any audience, but especially this one. So without further ado. Chapter 1, Virgil. April 19th, 2020. Cleaning notes, day one. Fuck, okay. I'm going to try planning this out on paper before I go at it again tomorrow. So day one of cleaning out Aunt Deb's attic was basically Vietnam. The war, not the country. So I guess it's really more like America than Vietnam. I wish Aunt Deb were here, not just because I wish she wasn't dead, but so she could fix this mess herself. Ahem. Good thing none of my relatives will ever read that. Call it meme or brain rot eroding my prefrontal cortex. Deb's death was comparatively low-key for our family, but that doesn't mean it's a fair game for quips. At least there's an explanation, though. She died because of a spike protein, respiratory droplets, Andrew Cuomo. No one will whisper about fairies or whatever their pet theory is when they mention her at Thanksgiving. Her body's here with us, not in the woods, TM. My 2 cents? It seems like the woods are just a bunch of normal woods. Not like I'm an expert, but after 48 hours here, I've seen nothing woods-related to report. I can see them from here, while the kitchen table creaks under my pen. Yes, I'm writing this in pen. I live without regret. I'm not afraid of the woods, but I didn't love the reception I got grocery shopping in town yesterday. I'd look behind me and whoever was there would have just looked away. Then I turned back around and the person in front of me would start reading the nutrition facts on a pasta box, like they hadn't been practically looking for nutrition facts on me just a second earlier. These people would know my aunt, but it's not like they can tell I'm related to her. They probably can't even tell what gender I am, and neither can I, so that makes total sense. I also got the feeling they were judging me for buying mostly Oreos and vodka. Well, my parents aren't asking for grocery receipts, Pam, so I'll do what I please. Still, I got out of there as fast as I could. If they decide to go all Wicker Man, the Nicolas Cage version, of course, on me, I would rather die somewhere more dignified than a Shop and Save. After all, there are parts of America where queer people are still spirited away by mobs, not fairies, and this place doesn't not seem like one. Nobody specific in the Main Street shops is obviously MAGA, but that's how a certain type of small town can be. Too folksy for 4chan shit, but they'll get you just the same. Worse, since they can hunt and skin deer and shit like that. Your average urban malnourished Richard Spencer type, just get them with your keys on a subway platform and they'll go look for someone weaker. And an SVU type guy wants someone younger and more feminine than me, but these are the sons of lynchers and witch burners and Shirley Jackson lottery motherfuckers. New England Gothic with a gooey Southern center. Do not trust. Re-cleaning plans, I'm thinking of classifying all the boxes as unpack or ditch. I'll then find either a garbage dump or literally just a ditch and throw that stuff away there, then dig into the unpack boxes. No one said I had to do this well, and it's not like we have family gold up there. This turned into such a diary entry. Maybe this will keep me sane. I found enough other random notebooks belonging to long gone family members that it seems like journaling is a tradition for us, right up there with disappearing out of the blue. Hopefully I'll just do the journal part. Virgil Sykes. May 7th, 2020. The cleaning is getting less arduous now that the obviously radioactive stuff is gone. I'm managing to impose order on the chaos, which is always nice. Weird to think this house has been in the family for over 100 years. I think of family homes as being like English countryside manors or something. Not falling apart 4 bedrooms in the middle of nowhere. When I sit in the little dining room, the windows show no light except for what comes from the house. Windows, porch lights, the little lamps mounted outside the garage. Everything else is like the space between stars. It's sad I can't actually live out here. Might be nice. May 18th, 2020. Was smoking on the back porch when I saw somebody far out in the woods. They must have had a flashlight. The beam was all I saw. I tried to stay out there and finish my spliff, but it was like my survival instincts were yanking me by the collar back into the house. I took a few more drags just to prove something to myself, then legged it inside. So anyway, I'm sleeping with some lights on downstairs, the windows and doors all locked and triple checked, and the room I'm in is securely locked with a bookcase against the door. In the city, I would call that anxiety. Here, in a house 10 minutes from my closest neighbor, I wouldn't. As I've been sitting here against the bookcase barricading the door, I've been considering this. Anyone approaching the house from the tree line would have had to leave town on foot after dark, walk a good hour straight into the quote-unquote haunted woods, and then loop back around with a very clear idea of where this house is. That route implies a lot about a person, doesn't it? If I hadn't been on the porch, I probably wouldn't have seen their light, and they could have walked right up to the back door. I can't believe people here think it's the city that's dangerous. May 19th, 2020. The room I'm sleeping in has a window looking out back at the woods. I haven't seen another light out there yet. Weirdly, I've seen a ton of shooting stars, making a lot of wishes to not get murdered. I've also seen foxes, rabbits, a stray dog with a limp, and even a deer once. Okay, I've been looking out there a lot. I'm bad at sleeping. I think it's just that now I'm here, it's hitting different how likely it is that I would have been murdered 200 years ago. That's not to say I couldn't be murdered now. I'm just saying that between getting abandoned in the forest for being neurodivergent, sent to an asylum or worse for being gay, and being burned as a witch, there were a lot of potential causes of death for a person like me in this town in the 18th century. In other news, the attic excavation continues. Today I found a bunch of photo albums and address books, that kind of thing. I even found what I can only call a turducken of books. A book shoved inside a book, shoved inside a book. One is a binder belonging to my other aunt, Virginia. I didn't know she was a writer, and it seems like she wrote about the woods. I put the journal by my bed. Next time I want to read myself to sleep, I'll take a look at it. I got some little stickies in town, and I'm going to make notes on the book turducken, like in college. I've missed my stickies. I color-coded the types of notes each sticky contained. Yellow for stuff to look up later, green for random comments, and on. I haven't seen any more lights in the woods, but if they're aware I saw them, they'll probably be more careful next time they come around. Another comforting little thought to add to the pile. June 5th, 2020. Someone knocked on the door tonight. The back door. It woke me up. I could even feel faint reverberations coming up through the floor. It was almost hesitant, the way you'd knock if you didn't want to bother someone. I couldn't move. I just stared up at the ceiling, then flicked my eyes toward the window, where I could only see sky and a bit of trees. If I looked out the window and down, I would see whoever it was, but out of pure monster-in-the-closet trepidation, I didn't want them to see me. They'd been knocking for a while already by the time I unfroze myself enough to reach for my phone. I checked the time, 4:30 a.m. I tasted metal in my mouth when I saw I had no bars. When the knocking stopped, I slowly slid up into a sitting position, trying not to make a sound. I don't see anything out the windows, but I think I'm up for the rest of the night. It started again, the moment I turned on my book light to read that old journal I found. This light is tiny. It couldn't be that, right? 5 minutes later, it keeps stopping and starting intermittently. I guess I'll just read until sunup and see if my reception is back. And I guess they might just keep on knocking. And that's, I guess I'll leave it there. And if you want to meet the other three narrators, you can go check out bottlecap.press and order this book. I think the link will actually be included in Catherine's description of this video. So yeah, check that out if you want to learn more. And I'm on Goodreads, Twitter, Instagram, all that good stuff. Thank you so much for listening. All right. Happy birthday, Catherine, one more time. You're awesome.
Thank you so much, Tenacity. That was sensational. You can find their tremendous book in the link below and follow them in the social medias linked in the description, where you could also find more links to Tenacity's writing. Thank you so much once again, Ten. That was truly fabulous. Next up is my fabulous friend Madison Matricula Roberts with her song, Out of All Them Bright Stars.
Hey, I am Madison Matricula Roberts. I just wanted to say thank you and happy birthday to Catherine for organizing this and for raising funds for the Black Trans Advocacy Coalition. This next song is based on a sci-fi short story by Nancy Kress. It's called Out of All Them Bright Stars, and it's sort of about feeling powerless sometimes to stop injustice when you see it, especially when it regards, for example, the treatment of immigrants. But the fact that we all kind of need to tag team because we can't fight every battle on every front, because that's how they get you, that's how they wear you out. So this is sort of a song of encouragement. Out of all them bright stars, why did he have to come here with his bird calls and politeness? What difference does it make? Out of all them bright stars up there beyond the clouds, it's not a mirror, not the future. Won't see nothing else, so you need this job, so you need Charlie, great big bully that he is. Keep your head down, fill ketchup bottles when your eyes see into it. Out of all them bright stars, why did he have to come here with his bird calls and politeness? What difference does he make? Out of all them bright stars up there beyond the clouds, it's not a mirror, not the future. I won't see nothing else, so do what the G-men tell you. Answer all their questions now. Straight faces, smart dismissals, there's judgment on their brow. Out of all them bright stars, why did he have to come here with his bird calls and politeness? What difference does he make? Out of all them bright stars up there beyond the clouds, it's not a mirror, not the future. I won't see nothing else, so my stinging, all the fury, utility and shame. Why did you hold up the mirror? Say your bird call name. Out of all them bright stars, why did he have to come here with his bird calls and politeness? What difference does he make? Out of all them bright stars up there beyond the clouds, it's not a mirror, not the future. I won't see nothing else. So out of all there beyond the clouds. It's not a mirror, not the future. I won't see nothing else. Thank you.
That was phenomenal. And if you loved Matricula's music as much as I do, you can follow her on Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube at Matricula, and tip at $Matricula on Cash App. You can also tune in to her show, Tricks 666, on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. Eastern Time on Facebook Live. And then watch the replays on her YouTube channel soon after. I actually had the glorious opportunity of being part of one of those Tricks 666 shows back in March. So you can find the link to that, as well as her whole YouTube channel, and links to all of her other social medias, in the description. Thank you so much, Matricula. That was absolutely fabulous. Next is my stellar friend Donna with a marvelous poem called There Are No Streetlights Down 719.
Hi, I'm Donna. I am a poet and a reader for Chestnut Review. I read poetry for that literary journal. I want to thank Catherine for doing another fundraiser. I'm always so happy to participate. So thank you, Catherine. Today I will be reading a poem called There Are No Streetlights Down 719. Just seven of us piled in the car, asphalt, moonless, double yellow line. We knew every curve, a sign, shape of a diamond, silhouette of a deer. Trees claw at the black night and blend into sky. The car is a horse with blinders on. Flick off the lights and float into space. Windows open, leaves rustle, engine strains. Music pounds through teenage chests, the orange ember of one lit cigarette. A single lightning bug, then again flick. Double yellow lines, the final curve ahead. The 719 bridge above the lake. Cast off shirts and shorts and socks, climb up the mud hill, toes balance on the concrete lip, poised, ready, jump. 1 foot out, 1 step off into space, a flash of light skin across dark night. Whoop, bodies don't tell us now or ever where warm air stops, where water begins. A head rush through depths, a moment, a lifetime, an endless bottom, a slow float back up. Only cricket sounds, and those of us who cannot, will not, not now, not ever want to go home. So for this moment, we are but lanterns, illuminated within. We bob on the surface of the lake. We glow. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Donna. You can follow her on Instagram and Twitter at Linoleum Rose, and can find her work, including pieces from prior birthday shows of mine, in the link down in the description. In lieu of tips, please consider donating to the Black Trans Advocacy Coalition via the donate button on Facebook or the link below. Thank you so much, Donna. That was brilliant as always. Reminder, while this is a marvelous show where I have the great honor to showcase some of the most fabulous art of some of my most talented friends, it's also a fundraiser for Black Trans Advocacy Coalition. Black Trans Advocacy Coalition does so much vital work and is the only national organization run by Black trans people that focuses on addressing inequities within that community. Their outreach focuses on health, housing, and employment, and I am so grateful to be working with them for a third year in a row. Last year, we raised $1,000 across multiple platforms. Mostly the Facebook and Instagram fundraisers, but also some direct donations via the website. So thank you so very much to everybody who donated this year, everyone who donated last year, and everyone who donated the year before. That is so many people. Y'all are so generous, and I am so grateful for each and every one of you. And please remember that if you donate directly through Black Trans Advocacy Coalition's website, to please email me at katherineroseturbis@gmail.com so that then I'll be able to know that you donated, and thank you. Thank you so, so, so very much once again. And back to the show. Up next is my awesome friend Bad News Bear with a medley montage of brilliant drag performances.
Now use it, now use it. We are the people.
On Venmo and $BadNewsBear on Cash App. Thank you so much, Bear. That was phenomenal. Thank you so very much to everyone who tuned in and donated. I am so grateful for y'all's generosity and so grateful that all of y'all tuned in tonight.
And thank you so very much to all of my magnificent friends for lending your talent to tonight's show. I want to thank from the bottom of my heart the incredible Stevani Ross of Sunday Comes Afterwards, the terrific Donna Talent, the wonderful Salem Quinn, the fabulous Tenacity Plies, the awesome Germ Lynn, the marvelous Ubleck, the glorious Bad News Bear, the lovely Refractory Period, the radiant Carlotta Plies Garzado, the out of this world Marie Hinson, the amazing Jillian Rose, and the magnificent Madison Matricula Roberts. And to close us out is me again with my newest original song, Hopeful and Hurting, about vampires and, you guessed it, immortality. Trigger warning, and I'm sorry, there's a lot of them once again, but death, dead friends, survivor's guilt, blood, biting, see, vampire stuff, murder in Minecraft, blasphemy, and very slight not safe for work. I bite her neck as protection spell, singing roll me through the gates of hell, and I vow as my eye sockets flood, lay claim to eternity by tasting blood. I sing of utopian romantic chorus like love-struck leftists long before us. Besides, there's worse things than the kills, stacked dead presidents like dollar bills. And I would love metaphors instead of feeling all my friends are dead. Try to reconcile I didn't do this, and yet my lips are that of Judas. I'd heathenously give up heaven to see us live past 27. And I pray it won't happen again. And good night texts, love you, amen. It's silver that kills vampires, and I'd rather that it would than to let myself believe that loss could make me something good. I'd rather keen and shriek and howl until my dying breath than to spend all my survivor's guilt just profiting off death. But all I know is how to sing, and I will learn to play. I'd sell my soul to see my friends survive another day. Succumb to darkness and become a creature of the night. If mine's a kiss of death instead, I'll bless her with my bite. So, as is customary, the Mixed Money Bags has wanted a little cameo in my birthday show. So, I figured this would be the perfect time to let them know that I wrote a song that actually references one of the songs of their favorite person, Lil Uzi Vert. See, I knew they'd love that. I sing of utopian romantic chorus like love-struck leftists long before us. Besides, there's worse things than the kills, stacked dead presidents like dollar bills. And I would love metaphors instead of feeling all my friends are dead. Try to reconcile I didn't do this, and yet my lips are that of Judas. Well, thank you so much to everyone for tuning in, and thank you also to everyone who is kind enough to donate. I am so grateful to celebrate another year by putting on this show for y'all alongside so many amazing friends. I love y'all from the bottom of my heart. And I really do hope I'm right about becoming immortal on the 15th, because that will mean I will have infinitely more of these shows. And so, in case I make it, I will see y'all next year.